Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
And then as far as caregiver instructed in medication management, the caregiver was instructed in the use of Lasix or furosemide and in the scheduling and the dosing of such. It doesn't change what you're writing all that much. Continue with POC, continue with plan of care. I was never, as a supervisor, very happy about that one anyway. But what I would say is return visit to establish patient success at the current home exercise program. Something like that. So those are just a couple of small examples, and I'm happy to talk to anybody later about some better ideas, because we all know this is about the documentation.
Thank you, Sandy. So I think that's a good summary. And once again, that's one of the reasons why we asked Sandy to join us. And we regard these presentations as very much not about, certainly not about me instructing you in any of the medical aspects of this, but about helping me understand what you're doing so that I can be kind of thinking about how Jim O would really work here, and have me talk to you from what I'm doing, from where I am, about how CMS might react. And by the way, I understand that there is always this tension in these cases, because people will say, well, wait a minute, all of the decisions that are being made here, all of the doctor's orders, all of your notes, these are all medical decisions. What are lawyers doing in this process, right? And but remember, like from the perspective of Medicare, if the question is just how's the patient doing, right, that's a medical decision. If the question is Medicare going to pay for it, that's a legal decision. That's a legal decision. The question is whether the thing that is being provided is a thing which, under the Medicare law, should be getting paid for. And that question is a legal decision. So this kind of documentation is really around making sure that you're doing something which, as a legal matter, somebody is obliged to pay for. I know it's a bizarre, when you know, because folks aren't necessarily thinking about doing things that way. Person has to need skilled care, by the way. This was really emphasized throughout the manual changes. That the notion that what a skilled person could do, right, or that an unskilled service is not being provided because somebody in the home is refusing to provide the unskilled service, does not turn what you do into an unskilled service and therefore make it justifiable for you to be there providing something which isn't skilled care. They were just kind of talking about, well, I know there was this kind of issue that, well, we're doing things because the family has refused to do it, and therefore somebody's got to do it and we're doing it. Well, that's fine, except that if what you're doing, right, is not skilled care, even if the family member is refusing to do it, then it's not covered by Medicare. And they were just trying to emphasize that point. So, a couple of other things. This is the stuff that is of interest to me regarding the Alzheimer's patients, which really kind of dominate our practice. So is there, and I just want you to think about this going forward for kind of after we're done, is there some kind of standing doctor's order, right, or a I don't want to say a generic form, but is there some package which would include sets of care that are needed for a person with the diagnosis of Alzheimer's, which is a legitimate diagnosis, in order to cause that person at home to either continue to stay as they are or to slow down the rate of decline. Now, when I think about this as a non-professional, as a non-OT, PT, I think to myself, in that plan, which would need to be ordered by the doctor, right? The occupational therapist and the social worker are kind of like the key players. It's really not the nurse, because of the nature of the things that are being provided in order to keep the Alzheimer's person's skills at the level that they are, right? But that kind of leads to me to the question of, so what does an OT do? I mean, I'm just thinking about this as a lawyer. What does an OT do? as far as Medicare is concerned, that is for which they will pay. And then the other interesting question is, so what is maintenance if you've got an Alzheimer's case and the diagnosis with Alzheimer's is inevitable deterioration, right? Are the services that the OT is providing slowing the rate of deterioration? Well, but if they're, maybe not, but if they're not, but the diagnosis is inevitable deterioration, then isn't just helping that person, even though they're going through that inevitable deterioration, a justifiable OT service? I don't know the answer to that. These are the questions that we're trying to ask. That's the reason why, actually, earlier this morning, I got here early because I'm nervous about doing this. Earlier this morning, I emailed some folks from the Alzheimer's Association, because that's one of the things that we want to be talking to them about, right, is whether there is a package of services that we can really look at as services that are kind of prima facie or automatically appropriate to folks at a certain who have dementia at a certain level because of Alzheimer's disease. So, with that all in mind, finally, playing defense. So, what do you do when you see somebody who is at home and they've got some real issues and you're trying to figure out whether to do the plan? Well, one of the things that you need to be aware of, is, or you probably already are aware of, is that you as a home health agency are never required to provide care. You can't be ordered by Medicare. Even if the doctor says that some skilled services are necessary, you can't be required to provide them. So. And I know from having talked to Sandy and from kind of looking at some of the numbers that the rug rates regarding this kind of, that the amounts that you're going to be getting paid for this kind of care are not as high as the rates that you'd be paid if you're doing skill services in order to do rehab and all of this other stuff. So really, you folks, you need to evaluate these as a whole and say, are these things actually going to break even? Or by walking into a case, are we going to lose money on the case? Because you are not obliged to walk into a case. Now, once you're in, you're also not obliged to stay there, right? If Medicare, if you determine after you've gone in, because the doctor has given you an order, that you know another a continuation of services is not appropriate, then you're not obliged to stay. And in that case, what you need to do is tell the patient in writing that you will continue to provide services if they want them on a private pay basis, but that if they want to do anything, they need to appeal, right? And it may be beneficial for you as part of the services that you provide to be knowing how that gets done and to be encouraging those folks to do those kinds of appeals, because it may very well be that folks who realize that they've got some legitimate chance on an appeal may be willing to pay for their services, continue to pay for their services, knowing that if they win, they'll get reimbursed by Medicare. Now, of course, if they get reimbursed by Medicare, that means you then have to refund them for what they paid you, right? So you want to think about if you want to be involved in that, right? But as we have talked to clients and as we've told GCMs, we think that the ideal players in this system to be dealing with these appeals on behalf of the patients are the geriatric care managers. We think they're the right people who should be filing the appeals. We should be supporting them. Lawyers should be supporting them and giving them advice, but they shouldn't be supporting us, because the cost, the legal cost of doing an appeal is probably not justified by the amount or the value of the services that Medicare is going to pay back. Okay, so just kind of think about that. Now, Sandy. Ready?
Yeah.
Here we go. So we know about this. If you qualify, there have to be skilled services. I don't want to do that slide. That's more of a nursing home slide. Let's start doing cases.
Good. All right. So on the case one, these are cases that were written. We're written mostly with the idea of the patient being in a nursing home or assisted living or some other case. But we can certainly, as home care clinicians, these translate beautifully to the home care. So the first one is a diabetic lady, and she looks like everybody else that we have at home, doesn't she? She's legally blind. Well, actually, she's had a below-the-knee amputation, so she's a little bit more in trouble than most of them. She's had some TIAs. She's controlling her diabetes with medication at this point. Obviously, she has peripheral vascular disease. That's why she lost her leg. She ends up getting hospitalized for unstageable wound on a coccyx. Well, let's face it, if it's an unstageable wound, the clinicians in the room, we all know that thing's a mess because it's so full of necrotic tissue that we can't tell how deep it goes. But we all, when we walk out of there, we know how deep that thing goes. You know, it goes all the way to the bone.